Do not let anyone dictate your career. Do not let them pressure you into doing a certain thing. Do not let anyone turn your fire or your light down because it makes them uncomfortable.
October, but I feel like this is already my limit. I just love summer so much. I want to introduce the guest of this episode to you. Her name is Lisa Hammer. She directs, she writes, she also composed music. She's an actress as well, a very funny lady, and she introduced so many new vocab to New York Reel. I don't remember ever talking about bitches and glory holes on New York Reel. You would notice that I was pretty surprised a few times when she talked about her life stories, like how in the 70s she found herself in a shipwreck with her family. And basically her life and her art are merged into one. She's a really great creator and a visionary, if you ask me. I also want to take this chance to thank you, my New York Reelers, for all your support. In the beginning, when I say, hey, New York Reelers, there were no New York Reelers because I was only filming my first episode. Now I have 14 episodes, 14 interviews so far that I filmed. And I am very excited to present an episode to you every other week. And that will remain the plan. I also want to do more vlogs and New York Reel field trips to take you on different journeys in New York City with me. Thank you so, so much for watching my videos and commenting. Enjoy my episode with Lisa Hammer.
We would just do hoot nannies where she would just play away. I wish I had like a margarita in my hand.
This is New York Reel. I'm Olive. Today my guest is Lisa Hammer.
Yay!
You are a filmmaker, you are an actress, composer, singer. You are the founder of the Blessed Elysium Motion Picture Company,
yep.
As well as Wilson Arts Diversified.
Yes.
Wow, you gotta tell me later about the German Expressionist films. And you are also the voice in the Venture Brothers. You're the voice of Triana Orpheus.
I am.
So a viewer is gonna recognize your voice.
Maybe.
And you have written and starred in your new work, web series, Maybe Sunshine.
Yeah.
I'm very excited to have you today on New York Reel.
Thank you, I'm excited to be here. I love your show.
Lisa, how many films have you made?
Oh God. I'm working on the fourth feature, and then I've made like 30 shorts.
30?
Something like that crazy amount, and like, two cable access TV shows that ran for 2 years, so like, 50 million episodes.
You got great reviews.
Yeah. And then the web series, and like I've helped people work on their series, and a lot. It's a lot.
Where shall we start? From the 70s, the 80s, the 90s?
Well, in the 70s, I was in a shipwreck at age 7. Yeah.
So
it's true.
That's not there. What happened?
That started the whole thing. My life has been a crazy shipwreck. Like, the ship was like filled with clowns. That's what my life has been. It's been really weird and fun. That was just a thing where my family went out for a nice outing on our boat, and turned off the weather radio, and then a hurricane hit, and it was like in near Gloucester where the perfect storm came from.
Right.
So we were kind of washed away. The boat was shattered, and we slept in a lighthouse for a couple nights.
Your whole family? The four of you?
Yeah. Well, three of us.
Three of
you. Yeah. So I was like seven, and so the next day they found my Barbies. Like, the people who owned the lighthouse had found my Barbies and hung them on the line to dry.
And you were seven.
I was like, this isn't so fun.
Oh, goodness. You remember, clearly.
Oh, yeah. It looked like an octopus was attacking the boat from the portholes. It was really scary. But that kind of gave me the beginning of the trajectory of insanity of this life of mine. Like, I don't even know what normal is, so I can't tell who's crazy and who's not crazy, so they all just kind of gravitate towards me.
So how was it growing up with your brother?
Oh, we didn't grow up together.
Oh, you didn't grow up together.
Just
because you're both filmmakers.
Yeah, I know. It's weird. It's really weird.
He's James Merendino, who has produced SLC Punk.
Yeah. And now the sequel, Punk's Dead, which we worked on. So that's exciting.
This year, right?
Yeah, it was last summer. We went to Utah and shot, and then we started editing and finished in, I guess, December, and now getting some distribution, so it'll be out soon.
Exciting.
Yeah. Very exciting.
So, you didn't grow up together, but you both had this dream of being filmmakers.
I don't know if it's in the DNA. I'm not really sure. Also, aside from being kind of half-brother-sister, we're also long-distant cousins through various inbreedings of... We both have, we're descendants of signers of the Declaration who married each other. And so I can't explain it exactly, but we're, aside from being half brother and sister, also the mother side, all the way back, we're cousins.
It's very complicated.
Because mine was the Stocktons and his was the Rush family, and Stockton and Rush married. So, yeah, very inbred.
So when did you make your first film?
Well, it's weird because I grew up doing musical theater and music. My mom is a beautiful singer, guitar player. I played piano and viola and sang and all this stuff. I did all the plays. And then I got like a theater scholarship to Emerson College, and like 2 days after I got there, the theater kids were doing like a really cheesy dance down the steps of the school, you know, like on Broadway, mm-hmm. jazz hands. And I was like, being a young, angry goth, I was like, this is not for me. It was not where my head was at all. I'd never touched a camera. I didn't know anything about making film. I just knew that I loved independent film. I loved European film, foreign films, anything strange and weird. I had been brought at a young age to see some Herzog films, Aguirre, The Wrath of God. I lived near Yale, so they always had independent film showcases. I used to watch Night Flight on USA Network, and they would show really weird movies, like The Residence minute movies, and I'm talking experimental films, like crazy stuff. So I always liked it, but I didn't think about making it. And when I got to Emerson College, I went and looked for a job, like a work study job, and there was something in the film room. So I was like, all right. And I got up there and I was like, oh my God. And just grabbed a camera and started shooting. And that was it.
And getting paid, you said, work study.
Yeah, got paid to fool around with cameras. I mean, come on. It was good. Switched over right away.
Yeah, like, I mean, even 2015, there are more male directors than female.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. It's still really skewed. I just joined something called the Directors List that a woman in California put together, and she's really trying to compile as many female directors as she can into a directory and say, come hire one of these women. Please. These are women who've made feature films. You have to have made a feature film to get on the list. And she says, stop, you know, it can't just be this male-dominated industry anymore. It's just, that's, it's not going to work that way. So come hire one of these lovely ladies to direct your film. So look for the director's list.
And all genres. And
all genres. Yep. It's pretty exciting. It's funny because, like, I used to try to get grants as far as being a female filmmaker, and I would go to the, in the early 80s, or in the 80s and 90s, I would go try to get a grant because I was female,
yeah.
But I wasn't making a socially conscious documentary. I wasn't doing anything that would necessarily benefit women. I was just doing horror movies and comedies and just weirdo stuff, experimental stuff. And so they were not really keen on giving me any kind of funding.
That's actually beneficial. It's good for your imagination. And
yeah. Got to make things work for $2. Because back then, like, you couldn't just point a video camera. It wasn't digital. I was working in film.
Mm.
I was, like, shooting 16mm film, getting it developed, bringing it onto a Steenbeck, and, like, cutting it. And then, like, keeping the frames in an envelope so in case I need to put the frame back in with tape. And then you send it to the negative cutter and pay for that. And then you got to get it striped to get the sound on it. You don't have to do any of that now if you're working in video. It's great.
Right. Now we just think about batteries.
Yeah. Batteries and little cards. Yeah. And editing.
I bet it was fun, though.
It was really fun. Because I would work in Super 8. My first feature, Pus Bucket, was shot entirely in black and white Super 8. And each one of the cartridges is 3.5 minutes. So you're shooting and you gotta keep, like, loading and reloading these cartridges. And you're just like, all right, everybody take a break. But it's fun, and it's like you put it in a bag and you're done with it and you can't wait to bring it to the guy who's gonna develop it and see what you got. And then you weren't expecting it to look so good. And it looks so good. And you're just like, wow.
Oh, film.
Oh, I love film. Oh my God.
I shot with, you know, camera with film. Remember, there's always this mysterious feeling of waiting for it to come out.
Oh, what's it gonna look like?
A few times, because you open it by mistake, and then you got nothing at the end.
Yeah, exactly.
So, if you wanna, if our viewers want to check out one of your shorts or feature, which one would you prefer? Would you recommend?
Oh my God, there's so many. Right now, I think you can probably see the one that's getting a lot of festival play still.
Yeah.
Is called Period Piece. It's a short, and it's rather experimental. There were film strips in the 70s, sex education film strips that were created. These were created to instruct the caretakers of people Down syndrome, who they called at the time trainables, because they were trainable.
Mm-hmm.
So they would make these films that you would look at and you would maybe sit there with the patient and would train you how to help them learn about their periods. And so they have this film that looks like it was made in a porn studio with a horrible, cheesy 70s backdrop with horrible lighting. The actors look like they just got off duty doing a porno the night before. Really sleazy. Sleazy mom, sleazy dad, sleazy sister. Like John Waters sleazy. Like female trouble sleazy. It was awesome. And a real Down syndrome girl who was learning about her period, and she was so adorable and sweet, and I just felt like, it just felt dirty and filthy. So we decided to get drunk on tequila and reshoot it ourselves. And so we kept the audio, but we lip-synced to the audio. So I was the girl with Down syndrome. I put on a wig and, you know, a little dress and kind of got really high on tequila and just did this kind of spaced-out psychedelic version of the sex education film strip. And it's been playing all over the world. It's crazy and weird and hypnotic, and people are thinking that it's just like, it's like this, like, high art, something, mm-hmm. Right?
What year was it made?
It was 2006. And it's literally just showed a few months ago at, there was a festival called the Unmentionables Film Festival, and it's about periods. And I got there, and I was so humbled at the quality of work, including films made in India about women's rights, films made in Senegal, films made all over the world about women's rights, where these girls have to drop out of school and that's it, because they get their periods and they don't have pads, they don't have tampons, they can't afford them, they're prostituting themselves to buy tampons.
What?
So they can go to school and get an education. It's crazy, it's twisted. So I was part of that movement and I'd love to stay part of that movement and help in any way I can to help these girls that just didn't get an education.
I hear you. We still can talk about sex. We still can talk about period, no. Which is a part of life and it's so natural.
Yeah, millions of years. However long we've been here, you know. I don't know when we started getting our periods, but probably millions of years ago. And just now, just this tiny, tiny, tiny sliver of time, we're all freaked out by it. Like, it's literally something that it's so recent to me where we can't talk about it. Maybe in the past 300 or 400 years, maybe soon, I don't even know how long it's been so shameful, but it seems crazy to me. And like, how did we get through it all these millions of years and hundreds of thousands of years before? Like, why are we suddenly, are we mm-hmm. going back in time? Are we devolving? You know?
It feels like that, right?
It feels that way to me. It's like, crazy.
I grew up in Hong Kong. I remember when I was fourth grade, like half of the class, all the girls are called into this one room and we have to kind of swear that we'll never tell the boys what happened. And then we got introduced to it, but it's still very scary. It's like the day will come and you will figure it all out. But I can ask my mom like before it really happened. Wow. Like it's all this mystery.
Secrecy.
Yeah.
Well, they're trying to re-educate men too to not be afraid of it because that's half the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know, it just seems so retarded to me to have the system where, I don't know if it's because of the patriarchal system, I don't know who started shaming us, was it women or men, I don't even know why, but I feel like it's just part of body shaming, I think, for women, part of controlling women and keeping women down.
Mm.
So we'll get over it, we're busting through. The films making the most impact are the comedies, because they're making it like they're making it light, and they're making it funny and like let's not hide it anymore. Let's laugh, and I think that's why a period piece made such an impact mm-hmm. because it's an absurdist comedy to the highest level. It's insanity. I've got like lipstick all over my face, and Levi's my husband Levi is in it, and he's got like weird makeup, and he's all sleazy. And my sister's got these boobs, and she's like flirting with the dad. It's just gross and weird, and I've got a weird octopus tied in my underwear, and like she's putting her cigarette on my head, and like
I gotta watch it.
You need to watch it. Yeah, I'm most proud of that one, I think. There's some others that are pretty close call, like Puss Bucket was pretty fun.
Mm-hmm.
About two retarded brothers who think they're being visited by the Virgin Mary, but it's really an alien who wants them to kill people.
Wow, it sounds actually, that was like your first few,
yeah.
Right? But it sounds so modern.
I know, that could happen now. Such a crazy, weird, religious country we live in. Like, I can't believe how poignant this film could be even more now than set in the 80s, because we had like the Tammy Faye, all that stuff going on in the 80s, and like so we sort of lampooned Tammy Faye, Jim and Tammy mm-hmm. Faye, and now there's like 10 million more evangelists and it's 10 million times more Christian. I'm more scared now than I was back then.
So what do you think has changed since then in the film world in terms of producing audience?
I think that things started changing in the 90s when we started getting the digital cameras. Now you can make a film with your phone.
Yeah.
Now there's kids, like, I feel like I went to sleep for one night and woke up and all these 9-year-old kids are making feature films with their iPhone, and I'm like, wait a minute, that looks better than anything I've ever done. Like, they're already more talented than I've ever been.
I like that. They have the resource.
They do, and they're learning from the crib how to use the computer, how to use the how to edit.
Oh yeah, babies know how to like enlarge photos on the iPad or iPhone.
Oh my god. So it, basically, at this point, everyone's a filmmaker. So I don't actually go around calling myself a filmmaker anymore. I'm an entertainer or an artist, but I mean, everyone's a filmmaker now. Everyone's got a video. Some people who don't even make films have a video up on YouTube, you know, YouTube with like 3 million hits because their baby fell over, you know, so I don't have 3 million hits.
It's like life and film kind of joined together become one thing.
Yeah. Well, Andy Warhol was right about the 15 minutes of fame, definitely. And he said everybody would have their own TV show, and everyone does. Everyone's got their own channel. You can just upload, and there you go. It's the Joe Show.
That's kind of what New York Real is.
Well, you actually take time to, you know, do your research and stuff. You don't just videotape a dog pooping, and then there's your show.
We can start another series.
That has its place, too. I mean, it's exciting. I feel like it's good. Also, if everyone's making a film, it'll soon sort of filter out that there are some that are high quality, you know, and some that are just for fun and entertainment. And everybody will find their place, you know. It's good. I think it's more democratic. So there's going to be definitely too many choices, overflooded market. How do you get people to pay attention to your new project? Like, you put all this time and money into it, and it's amazing and wonderful, but then how do you get them to come and see it? How do you get them to find you on the web? How do you get them to come to screenings?
Yeah, how?
How? I think at this point you gotta hire people or get Google AdWords or something. I don't know. We're exploring that now ourselves, trying to get with it.
Mm-hmm. Do you do a lot of PR yourself?
Yeah, I think it's right now it's about the ground game and just meeting people, going out to functions, going to concerts, going to meetings and networking, going out as much as possible, shaking hands, letting people know what you're up to, giving out flyers and cards.
Well, you are a natural.
Yes. Yeah.
Because you love people and you're good with communication.
I'll talk to anyone, I mean, unless they're an asshole. Even if they're an asshole, I'll talk to them too and I'll let them know they're an asshole.
So when people approach you, like over the years, you've done so much in film, in music, you have your solo album, you work with your band, your supporters, your fans, do you know like who they are? Do they come to you and tell you that I like your film and I watch all your films?
It's amazing. I love it. It's so sweet. I don't expect it. And there it is. Like, you sit home and you do this stuff and you're like, nobody cares. But even last night, we went out to see, we have a guest star on the web series, Voltaire. We've been on the same record label, and we went to support him and see his show, and people came up to me, and I was like thinking, how do they recognize me? Because I had long hair, I was like 30 pounds thinner. But they came up and said, you know, we've been fans for a long time, I just want you to know, like, your music is appreciated, and I was like tearing up. I was like, God, that is so sweet. Wow, that's just... really makes my day to know that you've affected someone somehow. And I get all kinds of emails and messages on the Facebook and stuff, and it's just, every message is so important. It really helps us keep going.
Keep creating.
So keep sending the messages. It really helps. It helps so much. I appreciate it so much.
You have a lot of people that like you from the Venture Brothers.
Yeah. Yeah, from the Venture Brothers or the bands or the films, and it's just a nice mix of weirdos.
How is, do you like doing voices?
Yeah, it's not my first choice. It's fun. I just do them around the house, and, you know, I mean, I'm not pursuing voiceover work as much because I kind of like being on camera, and I prefer, like, making weird faces and gestures. And physical comedy. I like physical comedy and sight gags and stuff like that. I think I like it better than voice work. Yeah. So maybe someday I'll pursue it, but I'm not really pursuing it as much. Can't do everything.
Hey, Lisa.
Hey.
I love your fashion sense.
Oh, my God.
I know that you started a few trends. And it was picked up in Japan, and everyone is, like, copying you.
Love it.
Tell me about it.
So in the 90s, well, obviously the 80s, we used to be Victorians, and we would wear, like, we would go to the flea markets and whatnot, and the you know, all the estate sales and get the actual full Victorian outfit with the corset and the top parasols and the boots and the dress and the bustle and the hat and the cane. I mean, it was like ridiculous. This is what we did. Like, we didn't have anything else to do with our time. And so I used to walk around the city like that because in the 90s I had found a rent-controlled apartment in Little Italy, Nolita, and it was a $300 apartment.
Wow.
And I split it, so I didn't really have to work. I didn't have to work a 9-to-5 job. I mean, it was like getting an arts grant. It was amazing. I'm so grateful I had that. It was an incredible experience. And that allowed me to express myself, to dress a certain way, to do the band, to rehearse 3 times a week, to shoot the films, to just take the time I needed to be an artist. So we would walk the streets every day with the full regalia, the folded parasol, the ringlets, the whole thing.
We, who are we?
Oh, it would either be me and my ex-husband, or it would be me and my partner at the time, who I made a TV show with, Dame Darcy, who you should totally interview. She's amazing. She and I were these crazy Victorians, and we would just roam the streets with our dolls and our parasols and crazy, and we would get our picture taken at least 6 times a week, like every day. And it was always by a Japanese magazine. Every time, we'd be like, what's it for? And they're just telling, you know, Japanese magazine. So a few years later, we noticed that they had started a whole new movement called Gothic Lolita, which is huge in Japan, and it's gorgeous and beautiful with the bows and the petticoats and the crinolines and the dolls and the curls. And so I think they had seen what we were doing, and then they put it through their filter, which to me is like really cool, artistic, crazy, creative, kind of anime all put together. And so they put it through their filter, and I just love it. I think it's even better than when we were doing it. And that became a thing.
I've seen pictures of you.
And then Dame Darcy actually turned it into I think she coined the term Gothic Lolita. I think that's her actual brand. I can't remember. Yeah, something like that, yeah.
That is so fun.
It's fun, yeah.
I'm gonna go take a look at your wardrobe later.
All right. But that was a lot of work. I gotta say, I can't do that now. Like, I was a size -2 at that time. So I was fitting into all that stuff with the whalebone, that, like, with the little tiny hooks that would hook up. And I mean, the size, it was like a waist, like 16-inch waist. And
wow.
I had that. I was anorexic, like, basically. Yeah. And they all fit, but now, no, not so much.
That is so awesome. I love, like, your colors and your pattern. I never seen you with a t-shirt.
No.
Maybe when we met one another at McCarran Park when we were working out.
I even try to coordinate then if I can. I love color. I love patterns. They make my brain explode with endorphins. And I've actually heard people who got a little bit weirded out by how loud I am, going like, oh, you just want attention. I'm like, I actually don't want attention. I don't really care about attention. I do this for me. I look down and I'm just like,
I'm so hot.
I'm just like, look at this pattern. Look at this together. Somebody made this. Like, this is like a beautiful Indian pattern that somebody
made.
I guess so. I don't really know. And then, you know, some other person came up with this crazy, weird, fake gorilla fur jacket, and I don't care if they don't go together. I just, there's a guy on his phone right outside my
window. I know, that's why we need a reel, like, we include everyone. Oh, there's actually a child.
Hi! There's a kitty cat, too.
There are a lot
of... See the kitty cat?
And the praying mantis earlier.
Yeah. Careful!
Your neighborhood in Queens is very peaceful. It's so quiet.
I spent so many years in the city. I lived like on the corner of 6th Avenue and there was not a minute of quiet. But it's so quiet out here.
It's almost like another state.
I love it. I love it so much. I just, my nerves, I just want to die in peace.
Too soon.
Too soon, too soon, too soon.
Yeah, we need more work from you. Yeah. More.
We need more period pieces about retarded girls.
I actually meant to pick on you earlier. If you use the word retarded, do people get offended?
Yeah. I try not to, because I actually love everyone. I don't want anyone to be hurt. But I don't use... I honestly don't. I'm so used to using retarded in the way we did in the 70s on the playground, like you're a retard. It's more like that. Like we used to say, and I'm going to start getting, you know, kind of offensive here, but we used to say you're a fag or you're a retard. And it wasn't meaning like you're actually gay or you're actually learning disabled.
Right.
It was just something that was the term of the 70s. That's just what people said. That's just what they said. And it's really mean. It's really awful. And it's horrible. And
I think it's really interesting how words are just words. But in different times of your life, you get really offended if your partners say, fuck you. But then on the street or if your friend's playing with you, then you don't care.
Oh, the word. Let's take the word bitch.
Okay.
Let's just take the word bitch.
Sure.
It depends on the context. It depends on the intent and the way it's said to you. For me, I've had it where it's so empowering. And I'm like, yeah, I'm a fucking bitch. That's right. Get out of my way. And then if it's from your loved one, and you're just like crushed because, you know, you don't want to be.
Like, I can't believe.
Like, I'm not a bitch. I just like things a certain way.
I love my friend Juliana, and I actually saved her phone number on my phone, Juliana Bitch Line. And she loved it, and I loved it. Yeah. You're so close.
It's like you can call, there's certain times you can call each other bitch, or, you know, it's like you're a hot bitch. But when it's really like a serious thing from somebody, it hurts. But when it's more kidding, I love it. So,
yeah. Maybe it's an American thing, or maybe it's a New York thing. I bet people don't get offended like that, like in Europe or something. Like,
I have no idea, because I think we should embrace it. I think we should take it over. I think it's could be a good feminist word. A bitch takes care of her children. A bitch, you know, protects her family. A bitch protects her pups. There's nothing wrong with it.
Amazing.
Yeah. I mean, that is a strong, you know, female. Whatever species it is, that is a strong female that's willing to sacrifice and willing to protect.
I feel like this episode is going to have the word bitch as in the title.
Yeah.
So,
ginger bitch.
I love it. So, with your, like, now I want to hear about your new work.
Okay.
And, honored to be in your new web series.
Yes.
Maybe Sunshine, that was the funnest.
You're hilarious in that. You guys are hilarious in that. And I feel like we do definitely play two bitches.
Yes, so Lisa and I were in the web series Maybe Sunshine together, and we had a fight scene, girl fight scene. So I'm gonna include it right here.
Oh yeah.
So they can see us. Yeah, so what is Maybe Sunshine about, and where are you taking it?
Well, Maybe Sunshine actually is my husband Levi's brainchild. He had heard all these stories that I had told him about my crazy life being in a band. Crazy. I mean, I had a midget manager who had like two giant black bodyguards that would rough people up to get us paid. And it was like, that just was the beginning of madness. You know, the things that happen to you in New York, the things that happen to you in a band, it's all crazy. The drugs, the personalities, the, you know, alcoholism, and especially in the goth scene with the vampires and the S&M and like the drugs and the absinthe and the crazy, I don't even know. So
the vampire like stalking you was a real incident.
Yeah. I went to a goth show to see my friends, because I'm not really into that scene anymore, but I went to support my friends, and I went to the bathroom, and I was going to close the door, and, like, the door stopped. And I looked down, and there was a pointy little shoe holding the door open, and so I pan up, and I see a guy with, like, the vampire lenses and the teeth, and I was like, hi, I'm just gonna use the bathroom. And he was like, would you mind if I watched? And I was like, I'm sorry, I'm not into that. I'm sure you're really nice.
Is that what you said?
Yeah, because you don't want to be mean.
To a vampire.
As a woman, you're taught to be, you know, polite and nice and not hurt somebody, you know, a guy's feelings. And he's like, oh, please, I promise, I'll just stand there. I won't touch you. I'll just watch. I'm like, yeah, no, no. And so I had to, push him out and close the door. But that's just one of many stories.
You wrote it into
your
series.
So maybe Sunshine is about my character is Lisa, loosely based on me, but Lisa Terror, being 48, trying to start her band all over again. And why is she even doing this? Why? She still has to deal with the craziness, the drugs, the weirdos, the sex, the midget. I mean, all of it. She just, you know, it's all crazy. The band life is crazy. Club life is crazy because, you know they don't make enough money. Just, I don't know if you know much about the Limelight, but, the guy that ran the Limelight, Peter Gation, was put into prison for, you know, drug trafficking and sex trafficking because you just can't make enough money having a club, running the bar, and having bands, and paying the bands. Like, you just have to do other things.
The Limelight is now David Barton Gym,
yeah,
and pizza.
I mean, that place was, every room had some horrible thing going on, and I knew people that worked there that were accountants, and that were, like, working in the back rooms, and they were just like, you don't want to know what I know. And that's just one club. It wasn't just the Limelight, but the Limelight is a huge, huge, huge club. It's a huge church. They had a lot going on. They had bills to pay. They had a huge staff. And so I'm telling you, they had to have some things going on. They had a glory hole room where people would stick their wee-wees through a hole.
I remember it being really fun inside because you get to explore and go up the stairs,
yeah,
and it's dark.
Yeah. But if you saw what was going on in the back rooms, you'd be like, I gotta go. Whoa. Yikes. So Levi basically said, it's now or never. You gotta make your story. You've been making everyone else's story. You've been shooting everyone else's TV show. I did Dame Darcy's story. I did the Pox Show. I did all these other people's story. It's time for you to do your story. And I was just like, I don't know. You know, is anybody going to want to see that? Like, don't people want to watch? I know they're watching Broad City. These girls are in their 20s. Are they going to want to watch, like, you know, an angry, bitter, you know, 48-year-old woman, like, trollop around on stage and, like, you know, like, she pees when she sneezes and she can't walk up the stairs. Like, she can't fit into the costume. Is anyone going to want to really see that?
Well,
like, yeah.
From the reaction of the screening of episode 4, people were laughing.
I know! I couldn't believe it! It was awesome. I love it too because you always fight with other bands somehow, either over the gig, over the time slot, maybe they're running too long, whether it's in the rehearsal space and they're taking up all the space and you get in there and it smells like ass and they're 20 minutes over and you just want to get in there and do your rehearsal and get out. There's always little fights happening between bands and shit talking each other. And
even within the same band.
Inside the band. Believe me, I've never been in a band where there was perfect harmony. Never. There just isn't. There can't be.
Everyone is an artist, so ego and talent and money. It is tough.
Emotion. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is your baby. This is your music is your soul. And, like, even though you all came together to have a specific vision, each person inside that band is going to have a little bit different vision, and they're not all going to be identical. And people are going to think, well, you get more than I do, and you're getting more credit, and, you know, well, I want it to sound like this, and I want it to sound like that, and eventually, especially when you go on the road, you know, we were driving, and, you know, this fight broke out while we were driving, and one of them was the driver fighting as he's driving. It's like,
Oh no.
Okay guys, let's just pull over. It's inevitable. It's inevitable because your emotions are high. You're already an artist, you're already kind of wacky, so, you know. I think the only solution either is to just roll with it, do a ton of drugs, and then explode, or, you know, be a dictator and hire people that are just being paid.
So how did you find the balance?
We decided to make a show instead of having a real band.
And you had real performances in the city.
We did. We filmed them, and that was good. We got what we needed, and if we wanted to continue, we'll see.
That day was so funny when my band Late Cambrian was performing, and you came in the audience. You were actually acting with your camera and everything, but the real audience thought you were pissed off.
Yeah, so we came into your show as a continuation of this fight we had in the rehearsal space, and me and Niabi, the bass player, came in and we walked to the front and we were like... And I think your bass player didn't know.
He didn't know.
So he thought we hated you.
He hated us. We were on stage and I kind of knew where you were, but I didn't see that you were so mean. And some people told us there was a girl in front, she was really, like, mad.
Oh,
it doesn't like our music.
Acting.
I love it. It's such a brilliant idea.
Oh, I can't wait to... I think what we're going to do, that's going to be like episode 4.0, because it's not long. It's not going to be long, but it'll be like... We'll probably have it come in where... It'll probably just be a music video we piece together of one of your songs. And then it has the storyline of me being like... And then we're fighting in the hall.
So, when will New Year Realists be able to see Maybe Sunshine?
Well, you can see the trailer is up right now, the teaser is up right now at maybesunshine.weebly.com. And we're thinking of, we can't decide if we want to release the single episodes or binge, so we still have 2.5 more to shoot. Mm-hmm. So we're either going to wait till we shoot all that, or we're going to start slowly releasing maybe like... October, November, December.
Oh, that's soon.
Something, yeah. But who knows? It could get pushed back, but we'll let you know. Okay. You will know.
So, there are 3 questions I always ask my guests. Lisa, question number 1. If you are to FaceTime, Google Hangout, or Skype with a 20-year-old Lisa, what would you say to her?
I would say... First of all, how the hell are you doing that? No, if I was a 20-year-old, I wouldn't have. Now, what I would say to my 20-year-old self is do not let anyone dictate your career. Do not let them pressure you into doing a certain thing. Do not let anyone turn your fire or your light down because it makes them uncomfortable. If somebody is uncomfortable because you're shining too bright, move away. What I did was I turned my light down because I didn't want to make people uncomfortable. And I really shouldn't have done that because I feel like I could have done so much more had I not been afraid to just let my entire light burn.
In what way?
I think that I was sort of afraid of hurting certain people's feelings and outshining them. So I took a backseat. I turned down some interviews. I turned down some opportunities. I made myself a little bit too scarce, and I made myself a little bit too unapproachable, and I don't think I should have done that. I would probably tell myself to just forget anyone else, don't listen to anyone else, you do what you need to do for your career, and don't let the boys distract you.
Good advice.
My 86-year-old great aunt said that to me. We were playing cards, and I said, you know, what is your advice as far as to the younger girls? And she said, don't let the boys distract you. I could have been an Egyptologist, she said, but the boys distracted me. It's true.
Okay, so question number 2. The 4 areas of life that we should be able to balance in order to live a good life, mm-hmm. with purpose. They are health, wealth, love, and happiness, mm-hmm. according to Ty Lopez.
Yeah, I totally agree. Health-wise, I think the most important thing, aside from stress management, we all know that stress will kill you. That's the first thing that will kill you. you got to find a way to deal with stress. I'm still trying to figure it out myself. Meditation, all that stuff. But I think health-wise, food is more important than people know. And I think that when you eat, you should, every single time you eat, you should be aware of what you're eating and look at the ingredients, and if it's a long list of things you can't pronounce, put it back. Because it's no good, you know, and the people who make that stuff don't care about you. They want to make money, and they can't wait till you get sick so that they can make money off the medicine. And that, first and foremost, the food and the stress, that's it. So control that, and you're good to go.
How do you not get stressed out in New York City?
Well, living out here is nice.
Like and, a suburb.
It's really, 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 really nice. Just chilling out on a porch. It's fun just going out with friends and having a drink, going to happy hour. I'm going to start meditating more, I think. I'm going to try to figure out how to just be quiet for like 10 minutes. Just calm down and meditate. But I think going out, having some fun, reading, bowling.
Bowling for health.
Yeah, seriously, it's good for your mind.
Okay, so then wealth.
Wealth, make a ton of money now and then break out. Mike, I had a cousin that said, I want to make enough money so I can just be above everything when the shit hits the fan. And like, I can't agree more. I don't know. I feel like in your 20s, you should just be a workaholic and make a shit ton of money. Do everything you can. And then find a way to just diversify, find passive income, find ways to make money on like a, if you're selling stuff on your website, or if you can make enough money to buy a property and have tenants, try to have passive income, and try, and then you can sort of slow down your week and like have other people do things for you, and like sort of if you diversify enough, you'll have little streams of income all over the place.
Freelancing.
Yeah, I like it. I don't want to be stuck in some 9-to-5 that's gonna kill me the minute I turn 64. I don't recommend that.
I've counted. I've worked 15 days in my life of a real job.
Yeah. Yeah. And you feel much better, I'm sure.
And then I need to freelance.
Yeah.
So how do people find out what they can do freelance, what they can do well?
I don't know. You know, I'm about to go to, my union has a job fair, and they have a counselor. If you can find counseling, like, I know that unemployment, they have, like, job training. And I think they can help you find a counselor that can give you sort of a test to see what you're good at and what you might be happy doing. And then find out what you're happy doing. And then at the job fair, they can sort of point you in the direction of things that would utilize those skills. So I'm about to go do that because, you know, I want to get different kinds of jobs. And so one of the weird jobs that I found with the acting union is you can work for a hospital and do crisis acting.
I do that too.
I want to do it because I'm a hypochondriac already. Yeah. So I can already sit there and be like, oh, because I'm already like messed up, so I can.
I can tell you from what I've experienced, even though they know that you're not real, you're an actor, they still get emotional, and then you get emotional, and then it feels pretty real sometimes in cases.
Oh, wow. Well, here we go. I'm going to try it.
So, yeah, happiness and love.
Happiness, I would say, I always think that you can't force yourself to be, like, happy all the time in the way they say you should. Mm-hmm. I don't believe in that. I don't think it's possible. I think it's exhausting. I have a trick. And this is not for everybody, but I trick myself by thinking whatever event is coming up, whether it's work, travel, or going, or like a social event, I just think to myself, this is going to suck so bad. And I talk myself into already thinking it's going to suck. Then when I get there and it's even remotely good, I'm like, yeah, this is so much fun.
Oh, that's so funny. But you still win.
I win. I'm never disappointed because I started with the bar so low. This isn't for everybody because I know a lot of people are like, you know, if you're negative, you attract negativity and blah, blah, blah. But I'm telling you, this works every time. When I think it's going to suck, it ends up being amazing. When I think it's going to be amazing, it ends up sucking. you know, and every morning I try to write down a list of what I'm grateful for. So I think if you're not somebody who's grateful, you're never going to be happy. You have to actually admit that things are good. Admit that you got something good. And also, I'm happier when I volunteer.
Yeah.
So it just helps so much. It's like you're helping someone, but they're helping you. It's just like a really wonderful thing to do.
How you feel fulfilled.
Yeah.
Because it's not, the focus is always on me.
It's exhausting, you know what I mean? It's just exhausting to always be worried about yourself. So, you know.
Okay, love. Any advice or suggestions for people who are looking for love or
Don't look for it. I'm telling you, when I was looking ever, nothing. When I was seriously, really, not pretending to not be looking, but really not looking, that's when I met my love of my life, my husband. I really was like, I'm not meeting anyone. but, you know, it's constant work. You have to know it's work. You have to work through and talk through every problem, every fight. It's not the end of the world. And if you are lucky enough to have someone where you can make a joke out of what happened, then you're gonna win. You're gonna be together forever. And make sure you tell them how great they are and how thankful you are for what they do for you. We forget that. It's hard to say. Sometimes it seems corny and we're just like, oh, I love you. But it's really important. I love to hear it, and I know he loves to hear it. It's just important to say to people that you, even to friends, like, I love you, I care for you, thank you for what you did, you're so important to me. It just changes their day. It really does.
Yeah, so don't leave those things unsaid. Like, express yourself.
People mostly can't say it, and I'm one of those people. I have a really hard time saying stuff like that. But I find when I do, it's magical. So you kind of got to make yourself do it and, like, make it an exercise because you feel it. It's just maybe you're embarrassed to say it or you think it's corny. But
it doesn't cost you anything.
It doesn't cost anything. It makes them feel so good. And don't you want them to feel good? You have to really want them to feel good. So just say it. Just do it. Even the little stuff. Even if they just put your shoes away, thank them.
Okay, so question number 3. What is your absolute favorite memory of New York City?
Oh, there's so many.
Memories of New York City.
Memories! The first one is shooting the Sisters Plotz. We did a dance number, big happy ending. There was like 40 of us. Just dancing in the park with a giant crane and a big film crew, and everyone's like, what are they doing? And choreography all together, and everybody coming together and doing crazy dances. My other favorite thing was bringing my husband Levi to New York for the first time from LA and just watching his eyes light up. He's loves
it
here. We came over and, like, I think the first time we visited was 2006 or 7. And then we came over in 2007. Like, we drove across country.
You met in LA.
Yeah, we were set up in a blind lead.
But that I didn't know.
That was when I was like, I'm not dating anyone, my friend Debbie. I was like, no. She's like, just look at his picture. I'm like, I'm not dating. No, I need to be alone. She's like, just look. And I was like, oh. Okay. Another great memory is playing at the Limelight with my band Requiem in White, and it was so packed with people. I think we opened for Typo Negative and Biohazard, and it was so filled with people that they actually had to carry my body over the crowd to get to the dressing room and back again to get on stage. It was insanity. I think it was totally illegal.
You crowd surf.
Just to get to the dressing room. Changing in the CBGB's bathroom for another show was cool.
You performed there.
Yeah, many times. Played in a lot of really cool places. I think in the 80s I opened up with a band for Ministry at Studio 54. But right as it closed, I think there was like a reunion or something. There was a blackout, I think in 2003. And everybody was outside in lawn chairs.
Mm-hmm.
In front of the buildings. I lived in Little Italy, Nolita. And all of our neighbors, there are a lot of older people, a lot of elderly, out on the chairs, like, what are you doing? Hey, Maggie, how you doing? All of our friends went by on their bikes, kind of just roaming the city, and we were just sitting out, everybody banded together. It was pretty nice. I also enjoyed, oh, there's so many great memories in New York. When I first got here, I was in a fashion show. It was like a retro go-go 60s show with Kate Pearson from the B-52s. That was cool. Working with a guy in a parrot suit who got into a fight with these homeboys. So this is one of the first jobs I had when I first got here in the 80s. So I'm handing out string cheese, and it's like polio, and so the mascot is a parrot, and there's a guy in a parrot suit,
yeah.
And we're at a fair, and these homeboys come up, and they're like, starting shit with a parrot. And the parrots, like, start talking shit back to them. And one guy winds up and punches him in the beak. and the beak gets dented in, and he's, like, flailing his flappy wings. And so he's like, I'm gonna fuck you up.
With dented beak.
With a dented beak, he's like, I'm gonna fuck you up. So the homeboys go running. And this guy in a parrot suit is running after them with these big claw feet. Like, I'm gonna fuck you up! With the wings.
Gosh.
That was amazing.
One of your first jobs in New York, you said.
Oh my god, it literally was one of my first jobs. There's Grant. We were just talking about you.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah, I met Grant.
Do you meet Grant? You remember Olive?
I don't remember how we met.
I don't know how you guys met. Do you remember?
Went to your show.
That's right! Ren, you were in the middle of an interview.
For your web series?
For her.
Oh, is it for your thing?
Yes.
Oh, very cool.
For New York.
You guys should come to my show on Sunday.
Okay.
Everybody gets a free board game. We're like 42 to the venue. So
nice.
It's like a movie themed board game. Check it out. It's
all right.
10 p.m. on Sunday.
All right.
It'll be neat.
Thanks for letting us know.
Nice. Thank you.
Neighbors.
Yeah, we've got great neighbors, man. Really cool, really creative neighbors. I feel like no matter what neighborhood you live in New York, there's going to be a bunch of creative people. There's just going to be. It's New York. There's going to be crazy people. There's going to be cool people. There's going to be creative people.
That's very true.
Kind of can't get away from it. But I think that the best has been the filming. The filming and singing in the bands, the different bands I've been in, it's like, being on stage, it's like no other feeling in the world. Being in front of people and just that feedback and doing your art. Being on set is the same way. Whether I'm working, with my friends on the Sisters Plotz with Lisa Ferber, Eve Plum, a great cast, amazing cast, or working on maybe Sunshine with you guys in like the funniest show ever. or making just weird experimental stuff. It's just, I love being on set too. It's the same feeling. And, eventually.
It's like summoning life, like a slice of life.
Yeah. What else could we be doing? Could we be working in an office? No.
I love that people just get together and collaborate.
I love it.
And you don't have to control the outcome.
No, you could just get up there and hang out. And I love when people just come to set and do their thing and they're like, oh yeah, I can do this amazing thing. And you're like, who are you? I didn't know you were that talented. Every time, I'm surprised every time, I'm blown away by the talent in the city.
Yeah. I call it the interdisciplinary minds. Like, yeah. We all do many things.
Yeah.
And we can all be good at them if we put in a time.
Yeah.
Don't let people tell you you can't do this, you have to pick one thing.
That's a really good piece of advice because I was always told, pick one thing, you can't do it all.
I was too. Like, where I'm some kind of monster or like I can't focus.
Yeah.
I have ADD or something.
But if we picked one thing, we wouldn't be here doing this. We wouldn't be doing, we'd either be just doing the band or just doing film. And frankly, I can't imagine, I know some people are doing it, but I don't know if I want to be in a band at 50. I'd rather be in a funny show about being in a band at 50. I've done that, I've been on tour, I've done the DIY, I've been on labels, I've been off labels, it's like I'm tired. I've done it.
I think this is a new art form, or more new art forms gonna show up.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's gonna keep changing, because you have this, it's like a reality web series, but it's a real band.
Yeah, but then there's like a goofiness, like we have this almost a Scooby-Doo, or you know, like a some kind of goofiness, because we'll end with either the meet, like the guitar battle with yeah. your band and my
guitar
band.
Battle really funny.
Or like the cat fight, or some crazy weird music video where we're running from the police, but it's very like monkeys. So like I think it's kind of like Louie, but then it turns into the monkeys and Sex in the City, and it's not girls because we're not 20 and we're not rich, you know, trust fund kids. So I don't even know. Girls, but they're 48. Old ladies.
Age is just a number.
It is.
We're either alive or dead.
Yeah. But I'm hoping that this show will stay edgy, and I'm trying to keep it like filthy in a weird way, not just crass, but just like really just kind of like, did they really just show that?
Oh, I can't wait to see the whole thing. Thank you so much, Lisa.
Thank you
for being
so
a New York
much.
Real. And even though we are friends, I don't get to sit down with you and talk like this.
Yeah.
And I love this energy. It's very peaceful. We can say anything, and we are exchanging energy.
I agree. It's really wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yes. If I can get out of the chair. I can't get out of the chair anymore.
We have a rather comfortable chair for this episode.
Where's our martinis? You